In him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth the noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee.
Yes.
Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation.
Yes.
There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon thee, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him.
Amen.
With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation.
Amen.
People sometimes don't understand the choices that we make. Sometimes the only choice is just to trust in the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I refuse to be afraid.
Right.
I have literally stared evil in the face. Mm-hmm. And I refuse to be afraid.
Mm-hmm.
I choose to trust in my God. I choose to abide
yes.
under the shadow of Almighty, where nothing and no evil thing can come near me.
Right.
Has no right to walk through the door of my home. Has
right.
no right to steal anything
right.
from me.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
But I have to abide there.
Yes.
I have to stay there.
Yes.
And sometimes I want to go fight my own battles. Sometimes I want to go and I want to see victory with my, I want to feel victory with my own hands. But it is not my battle.
Right.
It is not our battles. We are not to fight our battles. We fight our battles on our knees and with the words that we speak and the prayers
yes.
that we pray.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Thank
you, God.
Amen.
I shall fear no evil.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty.
Mm-hmm.
That is comfort. That is peace.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that cannot be shaken.
Right.
And I couldn't help but thinking about Paul in that prison. It stunk. He was beaten and bloody. And it was midnight. And he was praising the Lord. And an earthquake shook that prison. People die in earthquakes.
Mm-hmm.
It's a scary thing. It's pitch black. I'm sure they were in a dungeon somewhere. Horrible. Devastation. And they were praising the Lord. And they knew.
Mm-hmm.
They knew without the shadow of a doubt.
Right.
Things are not as they appear. The Lord keeps telling me, things are not as they appear.
Exactly right.
Things are not as they appear. We do not battle flesh and blood.
That's right.
We battle principalities and powers who come against us.
That's right.
And I don't know what else to say other than we shall fear no evil.
Right.
We shall fear no evil.
Thank you, God.
Hallelujah.
And no matter what comes our way, whether our life is a lifetime movie or whether our life is a walk in the park,
mm-hmm.
we have nothing to fear.
Right. Thank you, God.
My life is not my own. The battles are not my own.
Right.
I am convinced that it is in the gross darkness of this world that our light shines the
exactly.
brightest.
Exactly.
And when we choose to turn to him
yep.
and exalt him in the situation and choose to see with his eyes,
right.
then we begin to see that things really are not as they appear to be.
Right.
And the solution and the answers just happen.
Right.
And the struggle and the battle is won before we even get out of bed in the morning.
Yep.
And I'm telling you that it is so hard to rest and trust in the Lord when the anger, I'm a fighter. I want to fight the battles.
Yeah.
I do. I want to go get my kickboxing gloves and push something. But I got to go to the gym if I want to find something.
Yeah.
If I want to do some spiritual warfare, that is between me and the Lord.
Yes.
And that is between me and the principalities and powers of darkness that we have
yes.
authority over.
Yes.
It's no longer
yes.
I who live,
yes.
but Christ
yes.
who lives in me.
Yes.
And the power of his resurrection
yes.
lives in us. Every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes.
And to make us secure in our victory, secure in our identity, then he is glorified.
Yes.
And that is how he turns everything for good in the kingdom.
Amen.
Yes.
To go along with what you said, you know, when I was going through my separation and then divorce, and you know this because I've talked about this very openly since the very beginning, that moment when I felt led by the Spirit to make the decision that I made to leave the house, actually me do the filing of the petition with the court and all those things, it was a very frightening time for me. But as I was looking at that time, and even now when I reflect on that, that was literally the manifestation of my biggest fear. My biggest fear was that if I stood up for myself, I address things that were happening in my previous relationships and all that stuff, she was just gonna leave me. Which is why I never said anything, which is why things kept building up and all that. But the moment that I basically declare, okay, this is what I'm going to do, I'm going to take this step of faith because this is where you're moving me, even though this is not what I want right now, I'm making this decision. And I struggled there on this platform leading worship one time and all that. But when I made that decision, and when he told me, good, because you're trusting me, then this is where I'm going to take you, I don't regret a single thing. I mean, it was a sad thing to what happened, but it was probably the best decision that I had made, because that particular situation at that time, it was not what he had his plans for me. Mm-hmm. And look at all the blessings that followed after that happened.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where I am right now, I am with this amazing person, and I love her, she loves me, we pray for each other, we grow our faith together. This is something that I did not have before.
Mm-hmm.
And now that I have this person that I believe that the Lord chose for me, when I change my prayer from bring this person back to me, to bring me the person that you think is going to give me the desires of my heart,
mm-hmm.
and then she showed up in my life, trusting him and making those decisions at the moment are going to seem like we're making a mistake and we're going to be very afraid, because that's what the devil wants us to think. But when we just sit and let God move, we're going to realize at some point that it's the best decision that we are making, because we're going to see the fruit and the result of that decision later on, and then we're going to be like, okay, wow, this is way, way better than what I thought would happen had I not made this decision. So hang in there, because you're a warrior. I told you on Sunday, I'm telling you again. And standing with you like you did with me. So,
amen.
Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Yeah, Tim.
Yes, I just want to thank the Lord how he
senior year in the fall, and when I went back home, I talked to my sister, and I told her if she was opposed for him to come live with Kelly and I for the summer, not this summer, but next summer, so we could get him into the workforce. One thing that I noticed when I moved to Iowa was how babied I was by my mother, and it was really a struggle for me to adapt to living on my own and being independent, because that's one thing about Latino women. They tend to, I don't know, overprotect their children, and this is my perception of American culture. You try to raise your kids to be as independent as possible when they get to the legal age of adulthood. So if they decide to leave the house, they're going to be able to be self-sufficient. I was not raised that way. And I came here when I was 24 years old, and it was really hard for me to keep up with the apartment I had and all that. But since my nephew doesn't have a male role model, because his father is not present in his life very much, if he can come here and live with us for a little bit, he has this dream that he wants to own his own garbage collection company, and it's been his dream probably since he was 4 years old. He's had this obsession with garbage and picking things up and recycling. It was really funny watching him get up on Wednesdays at 4 in the morning just to see the garbage truck go past the house. He would not get up for anything, but he could hear it. One block down, right there on the curb, taking the trash can out. But anyway, if that is something that the Lord wants to happen, I pray that it does happen so that he can come and I can bring him to the church and for him to experience something that he's not experiencing in his current church. Because right now he's saying that he's with it and he wants to leave it. My sister is the one that doesn't want to. So that's one thing. And the other one is for my brother about 3 weeks ago just walked into his manager's office and turned in the keys to the company van and just told him I quit and walked away because he was so fed up with all the things that were happening in his job. And he started his own company doing the same thing. So now it's registered legally and he has his own tax ID and all those things. When he called me, I told him after he told me what he had done, and I said, well, congratulations on your own. And I said, I want you to do two things. The first thing that I want you to do is read the book of Proverbs, because it's the book of wisdom. And you want all the wisdom that you can on this new venture that you're going to take right now, being on your own. And the second thing that I want you to do is every decision that you're going to make, you talk to your wife. Don't make any decisions on your own. It's very important that you talk to her. So I pray that control that he's still trying to have over everything, he relinquishes it to God, because I know he prays and he turns to God, but it's usually when he comes to the crossroad, not when he's walking to it. And I want him to fully let go and trust him, not only when he gets to the crossroad, but also when he's walking headed that way, because I know he's really, really hungry for something to happen in his life, and I know that the Lord is going to use him for something big. He just doesn't know it yet, but I just know it because he has a way with people, and with the work that he's doing, people are just calling him out of nowhere, hey, someone told me about you, and I want you to do this job for me, and all those things. So, one, I pray that he is successful in his business, and he's able to get it going properly, and that it's very fruitful for him, so he can continue to provide for his family, because he bought a house like 2 weeks before he quit, which, yeah, he didn't have a plan, but and also that he becomes that instrument that God wants him to be so he can touch other people. And gets to experience the same things that I have experienced in my path as where I became a Christian to this point in my life. Now, all those things manifest because I want him to realize how good it is, how good our life becomes, how much better when we let go of everything and we give God total control and we start seeing all these blessings manifest in our life. So if you can pray for that, I would appreciate it.
Amen.
Yes.
Yeah, Mike.
I keep Peter lifted up for, first of all, a new job situation and also him to be able to get some good sleep in and then fight the insomnia so we're binding it
yes.
so we can get rest.
Amen. And then me and my family will be traveling to Las Vegas Friday. So this is a blessing. It's a free trip for me. My brother gave us miles and a free hotel room and to take my dad, and but it's a blessing. And for moving mercies, we're going to be moving. My dad and Craig, next week, I won't be here Wednesday. We have to sign the lease June 1st, and we start moving right after that. And then just for wisdom to know when I will follow. So,
amen.
Yes.
As you were reading that scripture, you said, abide in the shadow and of his wings. And when I hear that, I think of shade. Mm-hmm. And then I see an enormous tree.
Thank you. I love you. first loved us. Thank you, Lord. Your love is amazing, Lord, and you are love. We thank you tonight, Lord, that we can have confidence because of your great love for us, Lord, that you have us in the palm of your hand. Our lives are determined by your love for us. And we bless you tonight, Lord, and thank you for all that you are to us and for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Good job, Roberto. Praise the Lord. I didn't know who to look at for a nod, so.
I'm inking. She's blinking. She's nodding.
There you go. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless everybody. Appreciate you being here tonight. Again, it's Wednesday night, and I realize everybody's got jobs and so forth to go to, so I'll try to be brief and still be faithful to what the Lord has spoken to me. That last song was tremendous, and Toby's prayer, those two, along with everything else that was said, but those two especially kind of spoke to what the Lord has dealing with me about today and the last couple of days, in fact. And that is exactly that you know, circumstances, situations, they're constantly changing. We all know that. That's part of this thing called life, amen. But the good news is, whether things are going great for us or things are not going so great, God is still great. Amen. He's still the same. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And his love for us never changes. And there is, you know, humans, stuff happens, and you know, but with God, he's constant. His love never fails. It's always faithful. It's always good. Hallelujah. It's never self-seeking. You know, we read 1 Corinthians 13. I do it a lot of times with in weddings and so forth. But it's really talking about God first. You know, love never fails. Love isn't selfish. Love isn't, you know, one way. But God never loves us based on our ability to love back in perfection. His love is perfect because he's perfect and because he is love. And we can have confidence, amen, in knowing that his love doesn't change even when we're not perfect, even when we're not responsive as we might be or should be or would like to be at times. His love continues to flow to us. And out of that love, amen, comes all of the blessings and all the goodness of God. Based on who he is, based on his love for us, not our, you know, response to that. We want to love God, we do love God. But our love still suffers from humanity. And so we can be influenced by circumstances and situations at times, whereas God never is. He's seen the end from the beginning. He's loved us from day one. And he will throughout eternity. Praise the Lord. So I'd like us to go to Psalms chapter 8, Roberto, and we'll just read verses 4 and 5 to begin with. Someone's talking about the world that we live in and how kind of crazy it is. And it is funny how that a lot of times unsaved people, non-believers, unbelievers, skeptical believers, whatever they may be, have a tendency to only acknowledge God when something horrible happens that they can't explain. You know, something bad takes place, and then all of a sudden, yeah, there's a God because he did this, you know. Yeah. Otherwise, they never acknowledge the fact that he is their creator and savior, potentially, praise the Lord. So, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and has crowned him with glory and honor. Let's read that again now. He's talking about us. This is amazing to me. What is man that thou, God, Almighty God, Creator, are mindful of him? And the Son of Man that thou visited him? For thou hast made us a little lower than the angels and has crowned us with glory and honor. So, if there was ever a time, and just kind of rehashing what I've said, but if there was ever a time that the world needed an appreciation for God, for who he is, the remarkable, all everything, holy God who created this universe for us, by the way, to live in,
right.
to have dominion over,
right.
who loves us in spite of us.
Yes.
Today's the day when there ought to be an appreciation for that, more than there ever has been. Amen. When things go bad, as I just said, when something bad happens in the world that can't be explained by natural, you know, explanation, they make God the scapegoat. You know, it's an act of God. It's a, you know, God's punishing somebody or God's getting even with somebody. And the way that we can reverse that is to adopt David's perspective here from the Psalms. Every once in a while, I know I do, and I think we all need to ask God some questions. Questions like, why do you think about me? Why do you put up with me? Why do you love me? And the answer to the last question gives us the answers to all the others. Amen. 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8. Because God is love.
Yes.
Amen. 1 John 4 and 8. For God is love. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. We'll let Brent get up there just for the sake of making him do it now. He that loveth not knoweth not God. For God is love. God loves us because it's his nature to love. And out of that love, he created us. But he created us unlike anything else that he ever made. When you read the description of how God created humans, or how God made humans, it's obvious that we were special from the very beginning. Genesis 1, verse 27. Not because we're special just out for the sake of being special, but we're special because God saw us and created us special. Mm-hmm. Amen? So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. So think about it. How amazing this scripture really is. And when you think about what God did here and how he describes it, you can understand why God thinks about us. Why he bothers, as David asked, do you even consider us? Why do you think about us? And the answer is because we're important to him. Now, that's not being egotistical or self-centered. That's what God's done. That's what God says. Amen? God handcrafted us instead of just calling us into existence like he did everything else in the universe. Everything else he just spoke into existence. Us, he handmade. It was a hands-on operation for you and I. Amen?
Yes.
Hallelujah. And so it tells us that our God personally, lovingly formed us. Even more, he created us in his image.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. He is the prototype for you and I. Amen? We're like hand-signed photos.
Sure.
Reflecting his image. Bearing his imprint. Praise the Lord. Because of that, we have some unique qualities and characteristics that no other living creature has. Amen. We can communicate with him.
Yes.
Amen.
We have dominion. We have rulership. Even if we don't exercise it, we still have it. Praise the Lord. It was given to us. Amen. We have both physical and spiritual dimensions. And nothing else on this planet does.
Right.
Amen. We are spirit beings, but we're also physical beings.
Yes.
Yep.
So we can relate. We can interact with God, the Spirit. Amen.
What?
He created us that way for fellowship.
Yes.
Yep.
For community. For being able to commune with us and interact with us.
Mm-hmm.
To be intimate with us. Amen.
Right.
Genesis chapter 1. Verse 26. God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. Drop down to verse 28, and if you will, we'll just read verses 28 through 30. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. And God said, behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of the earth, and every tree in which the fruit of a tree yielding seed to you, it shall be for meat. And to every beast of the earth, and to every fowl of the air, and to everything that creepeth upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for meat. And it was so. Everything he created for us. That's why we were the last part of the creation. He created everything else, and then he made us and placed us in this environment that was designed especially for us.
Yes.
Amen? Praise God. So because of that, we alone are able to have relationship with him.
Yes.
Everything gives glory to God. You know, the Bible even talks about the trees waving their arms and the plant life and the animals and everything. They acknowledge God just through their existence, but they have no relationship with God.
Right.
They can't.
Right.
They're not spiritual.
Right.
They're physical things. Amen? But God provides for them. And that's why the scripture talks about if he would provide for the sparrows, who are just physical objects, they're part of the beauty and the reflection of God, but they're not in the image of God. They have no way to actually relate to God, the creator. They can relate to the creation, thereby acknowledging God. But if God provides for them, how much more will he take care of those who were created in his image, who are his own children, his own likeness? Amen. Praise God. So he calls us by name, and he cares for us unconditionally. David says he knew us in our mother's womb.
Yes.
Before we were, he already had a plan for our life.
Yes.
He already designed how that would be. Amen. And then he works that out through our relationships and through our situations in life. Even when we deviate from it, he, by the Holy Spirit, can lead us and guide us back onto the path that he has designed for us so that we can fulfill, amen, the purpose and the call that he has for each and every one of us. Amen.
Yes.
He connects with us in a way of familiarity. Amen. He connects with us in love that you can't experience with anyone or anything.
True.
Every other relationship is just a shadow in comparison to the relationship that we have with God. And that's why Jesus talks about, you know, marriage and so on and so forth. You know, he relates that, and he's actually talking about our relationship with God. But he shows us how that relationship is visible in the natural world. Amen. But it's always about the perfect relationship that we have with God.
Yes.
That's not dependent on our effort and our goodness and our grace and our glory, but all of those things, all of his attributes, are released to us without exception.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in every relationship we have in the natural, they're all, to some degree, we have to be honest, in some sense, reciprocal. I mean, if somebody's always mean to you, it doesn't work out real well. Amen?
Right.
But with God, it's he never deals with us based on reciprocity, on our ability to give back to him.
Right.
It's just a release of God's love to us. And that's the thing that causes us to love him. And in fact, the scripture says it like this: we love him because he first loved us. So it's a natural response over time. Once you begin to understand and accept this love that he has for us, we begin to loosen up and start to love back. I mean, because a lot of times in relationships here, we don't necessarily love because we're insecure. Amen. And we're always needing the other to prove.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And so that's what God does. He does it without asking. He just loves us so that we can be secure.
Yes.
So that we can get to the place where we trust in that love. And we're not then afraid to love back.
Right.
To trust him. Because that's the ultimate I think, the ultimate reality of love. It's trust.
Yes.
You have love, you really love somebody, you trust them with that love. You trust that they're not going to take advantage. They're not going to, you know, belittle or take, you know, or use you in some way.
Right.
Right? And that's the way it is with God. We get to the place where over time we learn his love is so great that it can be trusted. He's not manipulative. He's not trying to take advantage. He's not trying to manipulate. He's not trying to use us. He just loves us.
Amen.
If we never get to the place, it's our loss because we never get to really share love. It's like the cliche, you know, it's better to have love and loss than to never love at all. Well, that's true in this sense because unless we're able to get to the place where we can really love God, where we can really trust in his love and release our love back to him, we never get to experience the peace, the joy, the freedom that he has for us.
Yep.
Through his love. He loves us for that reason. He loves us into this relationship
yes.
with him. Praise the Lord. So, Genesis chapter 3 and verse 8. They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. So imagine what it was like for Adam and Eve. They were kind of like what I just described. They never got to the place where they really trusted God's love. The enemy comes, and this is what he does. He comes to convince you that God's using you somehow. Amen. That he's up to something to get you to do something that you don't want to do. And that's exactly with Adam and Eve. The enemy tried to convince them that God was depriving them of something.
Yeah.
That he was holding back.
Yeah.
So they never got to the place where they totally trusted in God's love. And because of that, they rebelled. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't trust God, but because of God's love that we've talked about here already tonight, and because that love is perfect, because that love is gracious, because that God is merciful, that love is merciful, because that love is not demanding, he reaches out
mm-hmm.
and gives himself, sacrifices himself
yeah.
yes.
in order to reestablish
yeah.
the relationship that he did everything to keep
uh-huh.
perfect in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. He made it possible for his so loved human children
mm-hmm.
to again walk and talk with him.
Yes.
Have fellowship with him. Have intimacy with him.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Even though we struggle to be faithful, he remains faithful.
Glory.
Not just to us, but the outcome of his faithfulness to his own nature is faithfulness to us.
Thank you, Lord.
So, if you understand that, you can see why, even when we're not faithful, his nature, his reality demands that he continue to be faithful
right.
and to love us.
Yes.
Because that's who he is. That's what he is. He can't change.
Right.
Amen? Imagine we're living in the year 1 BC. You know, we're, like a lot of people, trying to connect with God. Any mental picture that we might be able to come up with of this invisible, intangible God would be so vague as to seem unreal. It's what we deal with when we talk to unbelievers. In other words, our concept of God could be foundationally correct, but completely deficient.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, there is a God. But from there, I don't know. I don't know if he's mad. I don't know if he's happy. I don't know if he's going to get me, or if he's going to bless me, if he's going to, what he's going to do, because the foundation is there. But beyond that, we have no real concept. I'm talking about if we were in 1 BC. So what was the remedy? This God of love takes on human form.
Mm-hmm.
Comes to give us something tangible.
Right.
something visible.
Yeah.
Something we can, as the Bible says, the disciples said, in whom we have heard, touched, interacted,
right,
been touched by. Mm-hmm. We've seen him, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father,
mm-hmm,
full of grace and
yes,
truth.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
He who created us in his image takes on our image.
Uh-huh.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise God. He who gave us this exalted position that we read in Psalms takes on this limited, earthly, corruptible,
uh-huh,
image. That's love.
Yes.
That is what love really is. John 3:16. You don't have to go there. We all know it. But for God so loved his creation,
yeah,
that he gave,
yes,
his only begotten Son,
mm-hmm,
that whosoever should believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Or God life is what that is, eternal life. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Jesus came. He rescues us from our inability to come to him. Now that's love.
Yeah.
He comes and loves us to overcome our inability to come and love him.
Mm-hmm.
Another way that I've already mentioned before of saying that is just simply that we love him because he first loved us. It was impossible for us to love him because we couldn't relate in any way. So he comes and loves us in order for us then to be able to love.
Yeah.
Praise God. John 10, verses 14 and 15. We understand these things. I know this is all basic stuff, but you know we need to be reminded.
Mm-hmm.
Faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God and hearing it and hearing it and hearing it. And you know, we live in a time where God can become just a religious figure and so on and so forth. We need the intimacy. We need to know that we are loved. We need to know that there is no strings attached to this love, that God loves us so much that we can feel safe, we can feel secure, we can know that all things will work together for them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose because of his great love for us, because he cannot deny himself.
Right.
And he is love. Praise the Lord. So I'm the good shepherd and I know my sheep and am known of mine. As the Father knoweth me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. Praise the Lord. So we were lost, but Jesus, the God-man, amen, came to prove God's love for us,
uh-huh,
to bring us back to God.
Yes.
Yes. Amen.
Thank
now, you probably all heard the analogy, but I'll repeat it because it is such a good one. What did that lost sheep do to be saved, to be restored to God?
Mm-hmm.
It just allowed itself to be found. Carried back on the shoulders of the shepherd. Amen. So they can rejoice.
Yes.
Amen. We don't do anything other than we consent. We
sure
agree to the salvation that God provides.
Yes.
And God calls that faith.
Yes.
Right.
I mean, he is so extravagant in his ways of dealing with us.
Yeah.
Praise God. Ephesians chapter 2. I want to read 8 through 16. Rather lengthy here, but I think it's worth looking at. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 16. Praise the Lord. I'm so grateful for the love of God.
Amen.
Where would we be? What would we do? Hallelujah. Thank the Lord. Amen. And it's, you know, it's even the love that God has for the unsaved that allows grace to be released into this world. You know, people, they rail on God, they attack God, they curse him and everything else, and out of such ignorance, because if it were not for the love of God, they wouldn't have the next breath in their body. They wouldn't get out of bed in the morning, they wouldn't go through life, they wouldn't have any opportunities at all.
Right.
It's God that caused this thing to exist, and it's he that keeps it consistent. It's him that not only created it, but sustains it all.
Mm-hmm.
Everything would collapse on itself if it were not for the love of God.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, mm-hmm. not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, mm-hmm. created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Wherefore, remember that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ, God bringing us to him. Amen. For he is our peace, who hath made both one and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. He is peace, praise the Lord, and that he might reconcile both unto God in one body by the cross, having slain the enmity thereby. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
God's love for us is so amazing. Praise God. Try to comprehend the freedom that God has given us. And because of that, the confidence that he's given us in him. Praise the Lord. When Paul reflected on this amazing glory of God's love, he wrote it this way in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 12 and 13. 1 Corinthians 13, 12 and 13. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even as also I am known. And now abideth faith, hope, and love, mm-hmm. these three. But the greatest of these is love. Mm-hmm. And I propose to you that what we see through a glass darkly now is that we don't see perfect love,
right.
because of our imperfect humanity.
Right.
Amen.
Amen.
We know in part. We understand some of the love, but we can't totally comprehend it.
Mm-hmm.
But then we will know.
Glory.
Amen. As I am known. I'm telling you that there's a freedom in that, that we'll be able to love the way God loves us. And if you want to know fulfillment, satisfaction, mm-hmm. completion, it's being able to love completely, without
yes.
reservation,
yes.
without fear, without jealousy, without anxiety, without stress. Just be able to love mm-hmm. and be loved.
Uh-huh.
Something
right.
very few of us ever experience in a natural life.
Right.
But what God is every single
yes.
day
Lord.
And wants us
yeah.
to experience it.
Mm-hmm.
Praise the Lord.
Praise
and
the
now
Lord.
Abideth faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. Praise the Lord. No matter what we're going through, no matter how challenging the situations might be, think about God first. Focus on him, the God of love. Focus on his love. God is amazing. Amazing power, amazing grace, amazing love.
Yes.
It's all real. He is as real as the world that he made, that we see around us every single day. More amazing than we can imagine. More in love with us than we can comprehend. And it's time for a bigger view of God
yes.
and his love for us.
Yes.
He is love.
Yes.
Can you say thank you, Jesus?
Yes.
Thank you,
Jesus.
Praise God. We'd be a lot more secure. There'd be a lot fewer wars, a lot fewer, you know, violence and everything else if everyone could ever get to the place where they
yeah.
felt totally secure
yeah.
in the love of God and their ability then to love others as a result. So God is good.
Yes.
He loves us every day, all day.
Yes.
And he isn't going to change.
Right.
Sleep well tonight
yeah.
in the loving arms of our Savior. Hallelujah. God bless you all. Thank you for being with us, and you're dismissed. In Jesus' name.